can ask way too many questions.
And missing is key codes.
Okay. Rocky, do you just want to run the list of the folks who are here so we...
Sure. Rocky Rispero, Lizanne Skeen, Dan Bacon, Lana, Tom Erico, Jeff Virginia. That's all.
Okay. And you're bookended by the very smart people. There's going to be a discussion to provide direction from the planning board and guidance related to information provided within the Downs of Main dot traffic movement permit and the overall development pattern. This meeting is going to be run in a pretty tight fashion because we have scheduled an hour and a half. So what I'm asking is that in terms of the questions from the planning board and the transportation committee, that they be through items in item one, that they be for clarity only and for clarification. We will have a discussion at the end when we can talk about what we've heard and any directions that we want to get, that we might want to go in, or questions that we might have that would require more research or more activity on the part of the staff of the Downs to help us with our discussion, to help us with our understanding. And we are going to need that right here. So saying that, we will start with the General Downs Development Overview to date and the Downs team.
I
hope it's going to show up on there, because otherwise I'm not going to be able to see it.
We may take the projector a moment to warm up. Let's see what happens to that. I hear it.
Yeah,
it's running. District and Downs Road have been improved. There's been some improvements made in the Payne Road area.
in front of Hayden Lock Apartments, and infrastructure is into there at this point. The planning board has seen, I believe, a first round of the Redco site, American Homes, which is site number 11, which is now a care facility, and that is moving through. We'll be back, I believe, on your agenda in September and should have approval. So that's going to continue to move the downs road forward. That kind of leaves us to talk about the downtown area that you see on this plan, and the planning board members may notice that what we're showing, the alignment of roads in the downtown area is slightly different than the master plan that's approved. And our intention would be to come back to the planning board very soon. We're just solidifying this through the help of Goody Clancy and the downtown committee that we worked very closely with over the summer. But we'll be moving back through the process to modify our master plan for that area. But we think that's probably October work, October, November work that we get for you to look at. And we'll be moving forward with that piece, get master plan approved, and then we will come back and modify. I believe we have a preliminary approval on a subdivision in that area that also will need to be modified, and we'll move forward with subdivision approval so that we can then start to move forward with that area of the downs. That's going to leave still a large area, probably over 100 acres of land up in where it says mixed use and in behind the grandstand area. It will eventually come to the planning board with a master plan for that area. But that's what we're working on right now. It's an overview. I'm not sure what I missed, Dan, but twist anything for this.
Yeah. I'm only 1 minute left, so that's good.
All right. Very good. Does the board or the committee have any questions for clarity?
You were remarkably clear.
That's wonderful. We can move on at the exactly right time. Now an overview of the MDOT traffic movement permitting, and that begins with the staff.
Yeah, I'm going to jump in. I was asked to go through kind of our process or our piece of the process. And over the last 2 years, as Rocky said, we've been working collaboratively with the Downs team. I'm talking to town staff as well as the DOT staff. And so basically what I'm going to go over is really summarizing staff's memo that went out earlier this week. If you guys have read the into that, I think, to get to that, that point. And I will say it was very much a collaborative effort, and I really appreciate really the state allowing us to be at the table, as well as the downstream being responsive to that, our comments. So, which brings us to today, and I will say that the applications that have been in front of the board all fall within that interim traffic study still. So they haven't gone beyond it, but they're moving quickly. So the concern is really trying to get this traffic movement for the TFP that I think you've seen the draft and the packet that went out to get that signed. DOT, my understanding is they're down to maybe one or two minor comments, and I think those have been addressed. So it's really imminent that they're going to be signing off on their permit. And that draft permit is estimated to have, I had about 2,500 a.m. trips and 3,300 p.m. trip ends for the downs. And so with that, it allows them to continue through the build out. And so I'm going to leave, I guess, the downs team to kind of add anything to that. Because I know later in the presentation, they will be going through what that those mitigation projects specifically are by year, which is spelled out from the DOT in that permit.
No, it was a great summary. You know, I mean, I think it was a long haul. I mean, I've never, this is new territory in terms of the scale and magnitude of the permit. I mean, and I think, you know, Angela's right in terms of DOT really relying on the town to provide comments and sort of guide the process, which is a little unusual. I mean, typically they run the show, and so they recognize that the town was a big player in what was going to be in the permit and the assumptions in the study. I mean, I think all those weekly meetings, it was really about the analysis and assumptions about how many vehicles are going to be generated, where they're getting assigned to. And so we got to a really good place in terms of, you know, some consensus, and we had to work through some of those things, but good endpoint.
Okay. I'll jump in on this, some additional Downs comments, and I'm going to back up quickly, stay on track, but back up quickly in terms of the design of the project before the TMP, the first one in the modification. I know a lot of board members are aware of this, but maybe not as many transportation committee members are aware of this in terms of how the site system is laid out as it relates directly to transportation. So I'll go through this quickly because we have a lot of other stuff to cover. But I think it's really important to understand that within the project, we've tried to lay out different land uses to be at least impactful on the road system or sort of capitalize on the road system around it. And that's kind of highlighted by really focusing light industrial truck traffic up by Payne Road. I know the planning board knows that, close to exit 42, to really have a key and primary access in the future of the Heights Parkway for more commercial traffic, really to utilize the exit and the interchange in 95. And for the Route 1 area, yeah, it's a key access point, particularly now. But it's really supposed to be more of the kind of the quieter end of the project, more residential. So I wanted to talk about, just mention that briefly, kind of design for how it plays with the road network. Also, as the planning board's aware, we're working pretty hard on making within the project super walkable and bikeable so that people aren't necessarily doing trips inside the project in their cars, and also to be creating the opportunity for walking and biking over time to the site. So at the macro level, we're going to make this a big traffic permit, but we're also thinking about walking and biking to the site and within the site so that the permit lasts as long as possible and that we're promoting those nodes. Along the same lines, because it's a mixed-use project, there can be a lot of that, where someone can visit the site, go to work, do something after work, or they can live on the site and make it work on the site. So there's opportunities for kind of shared trips in light of the mixed-use nature of the project. And then also long-term, we've really been focused on, and this is part of the TMP, making this project a conduit for transit. So in a project like this, more than any other project in Scarborough can do that, and can be kind of an instigator with us, certainly, so I'll skip over the things that are covered. One really key point is this is a kind of upfront approach to TMDs. Many developers and applications are really kind of site by site. Like, we could have done this in a different way that would have different applications and always be in DOT for review. Kind of as we're trying to use it, they're going to get a permit, which is more conventional, but also it's a lot more work ultimately. And it wasn't really the direction we wanted to go. We wanted to get a large permit so we knew there's predictability for the town in terms of what improvements are done. There's predictability for end users so that they aren't necessarily dealing with traffic as they come in. You get the permit in place, know what mitigation needs to be done, and then they don't have to deal with traffic. And that's something that's already figured out. So that's a principle of the permitting process as well. This is important for the planning board, so we tried to project what we thought the development would be, and therefore the traffic generation for at least a 5-year period. And that's also how long the TMP is typically due for. So there's some reasons for that from a permitting standpoint, a planning standpoint. So in the permit, it lists a number of uses. They are in trips number of uses and units and square footage. Those are forecasts working with the town and DOT. That's not what regulates the permit. What regulates the permit and what we track is the number of trips. And we've already been doing that with the staff all along with the scorecard. But that's important for the planning board to understand where we're tracking trips. So if they're used, we're not going to track per what was proposed in the TMP because that was a best guess. Angela mentioned the 2 years of study and Rocky did too. I think it's important to point out that there are other really key players. Main Turnpike Authority was very involved, as was staff for the Western Forum. So surrounding communities also weighed in and it really influenced what the mitigation plan. And you'll find out later we're doing things in both neighboring communities, given the TMP mitigation plan part of the process. So in terms of when the improvements are required to be done, and we'll talk about the specifics in a few minutes, we're really doing the majority of them in the first 3 years of the permit. So starting next construction season, and all of them in the first 5 years. So, and that was intentional, at DOT's direction. So the mitigation would be in place, and development could occur, so it's not sort of reacting to the development that happened. It's in place essentially up front. The mitigation is a range of things, and therefore it's a partnership in terms of kind of paying for it and executing it. There are certainly project impacts that we're fixing. There's also impact fee area responsibilities that the town has been collecting impact fees for a number of years. Many of those fees haven't been put to work. So instead of the town leading the project to implement those improvements in the TMP, we're responsible to do that. The town's going to work with us on enabling that through the impact fee money flowing to the project to do that. The other piece of it is there's some DOT desires, obviously, in the TMP. They're broader than the project. They're really kind of corridor improvements, key corridors, one King Road, North Scarborough area. So DOT's requiring improvements. They're also committing to what's called a business partnership initiative. They're committing to state funding to supplement project funding and impact fees to enable these projects to be done because they're very comprehensive and they address desires and needs that go beyond the project. And then I guess lastly, the set of improvements are, I would call them pretty moderate, and they're more than auto improvements. So they include pedestrian improvements, they include working with Angela and the team, kind of signal optimization. We'll talk about that. And Tom can talk more about that. improvements that aren't necessarily just widenings. They're optimizing how signals work and the corridors are used. There are new intersections, certainly new capacity established. And there's also funding for planning on transit so that transit can kind of take off with this community process. And I guess lastly,
We are starting to, you know, approach the time. Some of what you just talked about actually, it seems to me, comes under the summary of offsite improvements.
Okay.
And review, so we can pick up anything else that you have, I think, under that with an explanation of what's going on each year.
Sure.
Unless what you're going to say is absolutely nothing to do with that.
One thing I was going to say that has nothing to do with the improvements. I know those councilors here are what we're working with the council and DOT on in terms of the partnership. So we're working on a three-party agreement and an MOU to kind of establish a partnership in terms of the funding of the improvements. So I think with that, time's up for the next.
All right, thank you. Board and committee questions for clarity. Any questions?
I have a question, although I think maybe it's partially answered by one of the bullets that you have here. So you're explaining that the overall CMP process was based on forecasted trips to meet overall site, and which is sort of a larger version of what we typically see for planning board site plan approvals, which would be a forecasted trip generation for whatever it is that you're proposing on the site. The last bullet point up on this slide appears to address actual trip counting, and I was just wondering if we can briefly speak to whether or not the overall TMP process, will that, and the stages of mitigation, will those be implemented per forecasted trips, or will you be monitoring actual trip data such that if you benefited from a site that had way less traffic than you anticipated for, it might you not have to do mitigation or vice versa?
So, as I understand it, we are tracked in, forecast is the right word, the ITV trips based on use. So the people found the manual of what use would generate. So that's what we're tracking, that's what DOT requires. So we aren't necessarily counting trips after the fact.
Okay.
That's how it's going to be tracked. We're going to have a scorecard like we've been submitted to the planning board.
Based on the ITE rates.
And the only reason to track it is to make sure we're in compliance with the number that Angela mentioned about what's in the permit. That the project has X number of trips.
Or not.
We're staying underneath that number is really what that's about. Those 5 years of permits are going to happen regardless of the amount of traffic. So you're within underneath that number.
Right.
Regardless of the trips that are being generated.
Yeah.
Now I was just going to offer that. Part of the early conversations before DOT really got involved, there was sort of Jamel, Angela, and I talking with Dan and their team, was really about trying to track the trips and, you know, understanding that there is sort of a wider margin of error, right? There's a lot of assumptions that go into 3,000 trips than 100 trips or 200 trips. And so it's like, well, it'd be great if that, you know, at a quarter build out, we can really see what's happening and maybe divert and, you know, and reconsider. DOT pretty much squashed that conversation and said, no, you know, you're getting a permit through us, the state, you've got to go through the ITE manual. It says 3,300 trips or whatever that number is. What are those mitigation things? And these are the target dates you have to hit them. So that took a left turn based on the first month or two of our conversation. We said, oh, all right. And then I know, you know, so just for what that's worth.
And I have a follow-up actually to what Jen's question, and that is, when you're tracking it, are you also going to provide a running account of what the money might be, what the impact fees might be? Were you doing everything by impact fees the way you did it before? In other words, so that there's an ability to track the amount of money that the town might have been might have been getting into some of these accounts?
We hadn't planned on tracking impact fees that we no longer need to pay, because we're going to be paying a lot more per trip than the impact fee would have been. We continue to have to pay two impact fees, the Dunstan and the Heights Parkway districts. So we'd like to avoid sort of the soft cost of the engineering exercise. It's something that we're doing yet. We're making an improvement, so it's...
But we will see the impact fees for...
Yeah,
so
mitigation includes continuing to pay impact fees for the Dunstan impact fee area and the Heights Parkway one. So that'll be calculated, provided to staff, reviewed, the board gets that, and then paid like a project is now. The other ones aren't, because we're actually doing a wide range of improvements in the lieu of those impact fees.
One other question. I noticed, I think, in the TMP, draft TMP, the number of 700 units was given in terms of, I guess, the development. I saw that figure in there. Is that from the get-go of the project, or is that 700 after the Gristmill development, or?
So that was just what we forecasted when we were asked to look in our crystal ball. And forecast the amount of development that would happen in the next 5 years. So that would be after Gristmill, but it's just a number. It's not, so our permit isn't tied to doing only that number or having to do that many. It's tied to the number of trips.
Okay, it was helpful to know, you know, where the count started,
yeah,
in case it becomes important at some point.
Okay.
Right. Go ahead, Tom.
So what happens, other than like the Dunstan district and the other one, what happens to other developments coming forward now? Are they still paying into the?
I think that's one of the things I was going to sort of reflect on at the end, but I'm happy to touch on it now, just in terms of, I think in the short term, yes, but I do think, and we'll talk about this a little bit further, that taking a look at our traffic impact fee ordinances is certainly right at the top of front burner, frankly, for staff, and you know, start to talk with the town manager about. That's probably something we'll be looking to work with the transportation committee on in the coming year. As was already noted, I think it was noted anyway, the pain road impact fee ordinance is now 30 plus years old. Typically DOT and they sort of gave the town a little bit of rash at a meeting, at one of our earlier meetings, of having an impact fee ordinance that was that outdated, quite frankly. So it is really, this is a great opportunity because, as we'll get into here in just a minute as we go through the years, the district improvements in those existing paved road districts are going to be completed,
right.
At least as far as were anticipated back in 1990, and frankly, probably much beyond. A project of this size wasn't ever contemplated. So really great opportunity for a town to sort of start over, if you will.
Any other questions for Clarity? All right, then let's move on. Now the summary of the annual off-site improvements. Dan, if you're the one that's going to be talking about this, it would be helpful as you go through this also to give a little indication of how you made the decision to do this first and this second and whatever the phasing is, to help them to be able to understand that.
Dan, just before you go into, we sent out this summary of annual improvements. If people don't have a copy, I brought a couple extra copies to anyone wants this morning.
So up on the screen, I know it's hard to see, so Jay's outline will aid with it, and I have a slide after this, is the improvements in construction year 22. So that's next year, obviously. And so there's some pretty important improvements that we're doing in the first year. Focus adjustments and widening on Payne Road by Inn Road, kind of really make that corridor handle more traffic from the exit to Down Road and past Down Road. That was selected because, really in large part because the Innovation District is really the active area of the project. Where right now, new development's obviously going in, and in 2022, 2023, 2024, there'll be more traffic using that intersection, so it made a lot of sense to focus on that area first. The same is kind of true up at Exit 42, just kind of given that area of the project being a significant one. The other key thing we're doing in 22 is working with the town and Angela on adaptive traffic signal system improvements on one corridor, which is the other plan here. It's hard to see, but this is showing you the intersection from Municipal Drive North up to Hillcrest Green Acres intersection. Updating signals there, doing some things the town is planning on doing, and asked that instead of that being pushed out further, that it be done next year to get those improvements underway. In addition to that, we're doing some technology improvements as well as ADA type improvements at each intersection.
So one of the requirements of the permit is if you disturb the ground, you need to upgrade the intersection to be ADA compliant. I mean, that must meet certain requirements for disabled, and so we're looking at it now. We're going to be upgrading those intersections, those five, to make sure that they are in fact meet standards, and then the signal system is similar to what you're seeing in Dunstan in terms of the adaptive signal control, and the town's had great success out there, and so basically those five signals are looking at being, they're going to be converted to an adaptive signal type control that would improve efficiency to the core.
Okay. I'm going to jump to 23. Do you want to take questions at the end?
Let's take questions at the end.
2023. So 2023, construction year, we're going to be focusing on the Route 1 corridor right around the Scarborough Downs intersection. So in 23, that intersection will be improved. There will be new signals. There will be additional lanes and more capacity to get in and out of the project. In addition, we'll be adding sidewalks from that intersection in both directions. One sidewalk will extend up to basically Millbrook Lane, which where sidewalks end today, to connect to the town campus, Oak Hill, and also a sidewalk will be added to connect over to Enterprise Business Park between the site and Enterprise. So those will be done. We'll, at the same time, or in the same year, finish the Route 1 adaptive signal system upgrade and the things Tom just outlined, but on the intersection south of Municipal Drive down to Highest Parkway. So I think that's six intersections that'll be updated. So that entire corridor will have that, the benefits of that efficiency and the new signal hardware, etc. At the same time, we're going to do adaptive signals and associated improvements at the corners intersection, those three intersections, and then do a range of improvements in North Scarborough. So up at County Road, 114, Saco Street, and I believe that will be integrated with also a town project because the town has a CIP that hasn't been implemented. And some of the improvements overlap, some don't, so that there's a great opportunity to kind of do that project in tandem so that construction traffic, construction occurs at one time, traffic is impacted at one time, and a wider scope of construction. So that's what's planned for 2023.
One other, okay.
Oh, yeah. Last but not least.
certainly not least.
So, okay, in addition to the adaptive, I guess what would be done in 22, there's going to be safety improvements made there largely in terms of raised medians to eliminate some high crash locations and update that intersection. So all four approaches will have greater kind of raised aisle protection for access management and some other associated things. Thanks, Tom. So 24, to answer your question about why, so we felt like finishing Route 1 in 2 years with the depth signals was important for continuity. That's why that's in 23. And also we wanted to accomplish the Route 1 intersection improvements, sidewalk improvements as soon as we could, because the residents living there kind of amount of development happening closer to Route 1. So that's why that's in the second year funding. The third year funding or improvements in 24 is really focused on the paint road corridor other than stuff that we did in 22. So essentially the area of paint road and then up into the main mall road from Muzzy Road all the way up to Best Buy. That's why I mentioned we're doing improvements in South Portland as well. So in that corridor, we're implementing the same adaptive signal system and all the bells and whistles that go with that for five additional intersections, or five intersections in South Portland, eight in Scarborough. We're making a pretty significant investment and improvement at Payne Road and Buzzard Road. So right now that's a bad intersection, it's a high crash location, so that's going to be converted to the signal to address those issues and make improvements associated with that signalization. So that's the most significant, I'd say, of the improvements in 24. And then there's some improvements being made at Gorham Road, where it intersects Payne Road, in terms of the left turn lane and the raised island there. And then the last thing we're doing isn't actually a physical improvement, it's design plans, engineering plans for future improvements to Payne Road at Gorham Road, which may relate to other discussions by the town. But something like the M project, we weren't having to make improvements yet at that intersection, but in the future they're going to be needed. So knowing what those are, planning for those, and designing for those is a requirement. Almost done. Because we had to. About 24 we wanted to do because we wanted to complete, obviously, as soon as we could, the Muzzy Road, the paint intersection, and update that corridor so it's operating smoothly as, again, new development occurs, people are coming out off the onto the paint road from the downtown.
If I could jump in, that finishes the last of the really heavy off-site lifts, those 3 years. And most of the work gets done in 3 years.
It also coincides with the BPI, the DOT's partnership, where they provide match. They wanted that in the first 3 years. And all the improvements that we mentioned in those first 3 years are ones that are sort of regional impact, that go well beyond sort of the project. So then we have a year off. That would be nice. 25. And so will the Motoring Public. And then in 26, in the TMP, there's the requirement for, if we haven't done it already, I'll say it that way, to provide a connection out to Hyatt's Parkway from the center of the project. And to make the Hyatt's Parkway Center Street, which is the road proposing the downs, center of the downs out to Hyatt's Parkway, that intersection, to build that intersection and have that be an access. So that has to be done by 2026. It's a significant investment by the project to do that because it's a new intersection, new signals, and also a long access road into kind of help with, if you will, because I think the best alignments to do that really aren't entirely on Hyatt's Parkway, entirely on Payne Road. There's some development projects that provide a better and shorter connection, better for a walker, pedestrian, and also shorter from a building standpoint, you know, either through the beacon or through a project that meets the boards are doing right now near Personal Plaza. So that's something, you know, we want to stay in touch with the board on the town out because it's something we have to implement, but really would like to partner on doing it in the best way possible. So that's what needs to be required by 26. And the last things on the list that are actually required kind of up front, you know, when we get the permit or short after getting the permit, are investments in transit. So we're already actually paying towards Zoom's bus service to the project, but it's written into the DOT permit. So we need to do that as a startup the first 3 years of their service. And we're partnering with funding to study transit through PACS. So that money's been listed, and we would pay that, you know, right after getting the TMP. And then DOT required what they call safety fees for areas that we're not making improvements, or maybe the town's not working on improvements right now. They're charging fees to go in the fund to address high crash locations. So there's approximately $150,000 that's required for us to pay DOT that hopefully flows back to the town for improvements to fix some safety issues.
I would just add that's something new, the safety fees that DOT is doing, and they're modeling it after what they're doing currently for DEP, when they do like wetland impacts and things like that. It goes into that kind of inland fees that can use anywhere in the state. It's similar. They wanted to kind of take advantage of the same sort of system. And so they see these high crash locations and are able to pool that money together and actually do some safety projects throughout the state. We won't necessarily see that in Scarborough, but they have identified some high crash locations in town.
I have questions from the boards of Bay.
I'm just kind of curious, how is this going to have any impact on the Route 1 corridor study, or is that still going on?
The Route 1 corridor study is completed.
Oh, it is?
Has a draft, yes.
Okay.
There is a draft document that does not include signal systems at this time, but that was something we were going to try to add in order to get funding for some more.
Okay. So this will all be brought together.
Yeah, I don't think, like I said, I think the Route 1 corridor study didn't necessarily address the traffic signals. That was something the town was interested in adding into that document. That's a PAC study that happened 2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. That
transportation.
Yes, pushed this summer. Exactly. But we didn't really get into, like, say, adaptive traffic signals and how that would affect the corridor and things like that for Route 1. It was something we partnered with the city of Saco with, and really it seemed like it was focused on pedestrian and
access management, pedestrian, bicycle accommodations, connectivity.
Yep.
So I think some of it overlaps, like the sidewalk.
Yeah.
Dan talked about that, the Route 1 down sort of intersection, and then some of the upgrades.
And I was thinking of the islands.
The islands were part of that,
right?
In terms of controlling driveway movements, right?
Right. So Tom was the project manager for that project,
yeah.
So that's in marriage, I think, to actually to what we're doing some of this work along that Route 1 corridor, so they're intimately a part of that project.
One other question on Payne Road. There's no widening of Payne Road between the site and Safer Shots. Road intersections.
anymore.
That if they're saying, DOT is saying not warranted from their standpoint, statewide level for them to include this permit, it could be something we talk about locally or even when we go into revamping the traffic impact fees, because that is, it's a large crossing. Whether it's a culvert or a bridge, it's still a significant project.
And
as far as costs go, I guess, too, and environmental sensitivity and all kinds of things that need to be factored in.
I think in terms of what I'm hearing from the board, that was also going to be my question about the bridge. So I guess a lot of people will be watching what happens in terms of that bridge. Right now, it certainly is a pinch point along Payne Road, and the more the traffic comes, the more it's going to be a pinch point, and it is over the Nonsuch River, which we are preserving more and more along the banks. So any other questions?
Just one other thing.
For clarity.
If these are these are significant impacts in the town, and I just would be, I would urge you guys, I know you do a nice job at the Downs already with your posters up there explaining what's going on, but I just think the town should make sure they do that around the town whenever something's happening. Mm-hmm. So the citizens, I mean, we're talking about multiple years here.
Oh, sure.
And all of a sudden somebody in out at 8th Pond is all of a sudden see some stuff going on. They may forget what it's all about, you know.
I also should note that in the material that Jay passed out, sent to us, the Downs TMP offsite improvement summaries that he mentioned, there is money from the town reserve accounts that is listed. So that's what the town has available for those areas. So it's not just the Downs that's putting in money. The town itself is also making quite a contribution, and the people of the town, I hopefully are aware of that too, that the impact fees that town has been collecting for years is now going to be put to good use to really change the transportation structure.
That's not taxpayers' money.
It is not taxpayers' money, and that's the wonderful thing. There is money available that is not taxpayer money that is going to go into ease the transportation woes of quite a few areas in Scarborough.
Just a thought, given the span of these improvements, has the DOT or anybody talked to the group about potential use of ARPA funds that are coming in from the recovery that is designed for infrastructure and those kind of things, and would that be something the team could look towards and maybe speed up some of the mitigation that's going to happen so that it can be done quicker? I mean, that's part of the whole plan.
For PACs, you know, PACs, so regionally, there's money coming in as well.
Yeah.
I would suggest that that's, we can hold that for discussion. It really goes, additional funding sources are always to be devoutly hoped for. But it really is not part of the TMP that we're looking at right now, but I do think it's...
somebody's got to pay for it.
Yeah, I do think it's a good avenue to explore, and I'm sure the town will do that.
Yeah, I just wanted to offer the guidance we have from Treasury is for capital projects, water, sewer, and broadband are the only ones that qualify. So there may be some portion of these projects, but not a large part.
Thank you. All right, and
trying to find more money.
Moving on. I'm sorry, Greg DePerry. I do tend to look to my left more than my right.
I don't need a dissertation on it, but there's, 2022, we're doing adaptive traffic systems in 5 intersections, and then 23, we're doing 5. Intersection of 1 or 3 more, 8 corners, and 2 or more Scarborough. Can someone tell me what an adaptive traffic system is? Because I think there's probably some people looking through the camera that have no idea.
Sure.
Either.
Okay, that's a, what that's a,
I'm
who can answer it in the shortest amount of time in a way that is.
You're asking two engineers that question.
I know, but I've learned that sometimes as planners also.
I did preface it with 3 minutes.
I'll be quick. It's a very smart signal. You basically install equipment technology that is monitoring traffic and changing timings to reflect what it has learned from like previous timings.
Okay. So it's not just to do with pedestrian signaling. It's more to do with like an artificial intelligence kind
and
of.
And the volume coming at it. So we talked about that. The transportation group. One of the things is like when people set a light, they know. Okay, that turned green on the side of I'm next. That doesn't happen anymore. A smart signal.
Yeah.
It's really based on the flow coming at it. So trying to get that cue through. So when we're talking about a corridor, it's really about kind of that keeping that flow going through the main corridor, which means that some of the side streets might have to wait a little longer, but the volume of traffic that you're moving through that corridor is going to increase based on just what it sees. It's like having someone out there knowing, I got this
So the idea is the control is going to learn and make
smart thermostat on a traffic signal.
So it knows like if you're getting traffic
on real time,
a turn road, to go, right? To get through the dense intersection, that's working well.
That was good. I think it was less than 10.
So I think it's worth noting for folks, and Angela, correct my number, but just as an example, so when the town put the adaptive signals in Dunston 3, 4, 5 years ago, the number I've heard is a 24% increase in improvement. So decrease in delay, increase in improvement, efficiency, increase in efficiency. Thank you, Janelle.
All right, thank you. Any more questions about this from the board and the committees? All right, let us move on to the update from staff of other considerations, and we may have heard a lot of them.
Yeah, you have. I was going to spend a little bit of time talking about this being an opportunity to update our impact fee ordinance, but you know that's really not part of the TMP or really part of the planning board's review. So what I'll do is jump to really sort of next steps and expectations for the planning board. We've talked about how so far the development you've been reviewing have either been under that first traffic movement permit of 2019 or under the interim study. So what we'll see is with the next formal application that comes before you, we're going to go over the number of trips that are in that interim study. So that's when the planning board will get its first sort of formal review of the traffic. You're going to get, you know, more materials than you could ever hope to deal with. But so I think that's when the planning board will take formal action on additional traffic. And so just sort of want to let folks know that this is really intended to sort of inform and educate that next discussion. And so really, we've talked about there's been very collaborative process between the Downs, DOT, and town. And by and large, you know, we've talked about a number of different improvements outside of what you're seeing on this list, and some have come off the list, some have been added to the list. And so at this point, there's very few remaining items that the town thinks locally aren't embedded in here, but there may be a couple additional items that come along to talk about, we've talked about potential for an additional right turn lane from Payne Road into Downs. But these are the type of things that as we review the studies, you'll see memos, our traffic engineers will provide memos. So I just want to preface that there you know, maybe a few things, not much, but by and large, I think staff's, you know, like I said, been at the table and thinks this TMP has largely hit the mark. The other thing I wanted to touch on, and really sort of the one of the key pieces for the board's consideration at the next step, is going to be around the construction in lieu of impact fees, right? We've been talking a lot about that, but that's really an action of this planning board. That's spelled out in the Payne Road impact fee ordinance, that if the town finds that it's more advantageous to have construction occur in lieu of paying impact fees, for a number of reasons, in terms of efficiencies, just getting the project done, then the planning board is the one who actually needs to make that a formal finding. So that's certainly going to be a recommendation you're going to see from staff that you consider doing that. We do have, I think the question came up earlier and I didn't get an opportunity to answer it, but we've had our town peer review consultant take a look at sort of the cost difference in impact fees and construction costs. And at a conservative estimate level, it's anticipated that construction is going to be on the order of $5 million than impact fee. And again, keep in mind, the paving road impact fee was written in 1990, so it clearly didn't contemplate, even if it was written more recently, it wouldn't contemplate a project of this size. There's never been, you know, we have one of our traffic engineers, Phil Bray, who you all have seen his name, has been in this game for 50 years. He's never seen a project of this size. You know, the state can't remember a project of this size. So we really are dealing with something very, just the size and scale that we've been building the plane as we're flying it, and we're about to land it, we think. So those are just a couple of things I wanted to sort of plant the seed for ongoing discussions. And if there's any questions as related to that, you know, we'll try to answer those tonight, or be prepared to bring additional information forward when it does formally come before the board.
Is this the clarity? Because we also have an opportunity for discussion now. But if you have a question, Jay, go ahead.
Well, I think so. let's say another larger project comes on. Will those impact fees go directly to the existing like districts and things, or to this project?
So current, the ordinance is in place currently. Yeah. So people have to play by the current rules. So if another project comes in, big or small, those impact fees, you know, they get approved before these things are done. And, you know, quite frankly, fortunately, these get done in pretty short order here. They would pay into the reserve account. That ordinance is still in place. I think part of the discussion, and really it's a council action, how those reserve funds get used. And the Downs team has already started that, and you saw, I think everyone hopefully had a chance to watch that workshop in June, which is the start of that conversation around, you know, understanding that the town has been collecting these fees in some cases for 30 years. It hasn't been able to, you know, get to a final improvement in the area, and this is really an opportunity to leverage private dollars and public dollars that were, I should say, not taxpayer dollars, right? As we already said, these were dollars that were have been accumulated through other development reviews and developers and held in reserve accounts for these specific improvement areas.
Just for the Transportation Committee members here too, I know Jay had alluded to talking about, like, as we go into looking at revamping the traffic impact fees, one of the things that, like, Dan pointed out, but the Gore Road, King Road intersection is one that a full design will be provided, a design of that intersection, the improvements needed. However, they weren't really triggering the need for construction, which is, I would say, like a building block for us to start with for transportation to look at what, how those, we can revisit the traffic impact fees. And so here's a starting point, here's a project that we can kind of cost out and say, we're gonna need to build this. And the whole premise of the impact fees is really, so the last one isn't paying for the full share. It's really, everyone has a little bite of that apple and paying into to get to those, that point. And I will say also, because of the collaborative effort and looking at all the data that we had for a very large area, when we look at
from Jay or Jamel to see if I'm reading this correctly, but on page 4 of the mixed-use development for the Downs, the draft TMP, under the off-site mitigation, it looks as though there's a role for the planning board that's listed in there, that the developer has to do a review completed by November 1st of the calendar year before the, before the required completion calendar year. And that the review has to be done actually within the town, and it looks as though it's the role of the planning board to do that. Am I correct for that?
Yeah, not entirely. What I'd say the role of the planning board, as we typically do with traffic movement permits, is there are concept plans that with each one of the improvements that Dan and the team laid out in the traffic movement permit, there are concept plans. And so what we typically do as a town through the planning board review process is review those concept plans and sort of say, yep, that's the improvement we think is the correct improvement. From there, and this is where Tom and Angela will correct me where I completely go astray, the engineers take those concept plans and need to do much further refinement and engineering on the plans, but essentially what gets built generally looks like what's on those concept plans. So we don't bring those final design plans back to the planning board because the planning board has already blessed the general layout, the general design, right turn lanes, left turn lanes, sidewalks, whatever the case may be.
Each year.
What's that? No, so we're going to, I think, so what the expectation is that the planning board is going to approve is 3,303 trips in the Downs with this as the mitigation plan. And like I said, when you receive the TMP, and actually I think in that Dropbox folder was all those concept plans. And so as part of the planning board's traffic approval with each subsequent application that comes in, like we do now, like we have now, there's a standing condition that says, okay, I can't remember exactly what it says, but this development can go forward in accordance with the traffic approved previously. We'll say something to the effect of, okay, moving forward, condition of approval, this development can move forward so long as the conditions of the DOT, TMP, permit number XYZ are adhered to. And so it's going to be one blanket approval, and whether they hit that 3,303 trips in year one or year 10 for the town, it doesn't much matter because we're just going to be tracking against that trip number. And we know exactly what's going to get built and approved and what will mitigate that amount of impact. As soon as they try to go over that number, that's when we'll sort of say, time out, you got to start over.
And I think you need to reread the offsite mitigation phasing plan and fees because what you just said is not exactly what I read in here, which basically states that something has to be done each year.
Does need to be done each year.
Yeah, so my, I think for clarity, it would be very helpful for the planning board to have non-legal language explaining our role. And the other thing is there seems to be specific timelines connected with approval prior to submission by the applicant. And that requires that the applicant may, or the town may have to get something to us how many weeks in advance, but depending upon when our meetings are, and then 2 weeks to us or a week to us before our meetings. So there needs to be some sort of a calendar, a PIPRA file.
I guess what I would circle back to the expectations that does not come back to the planning board.
I think you need to read this.
And so this is the DOT's language, so we'll try to clarify that with them. Hopefully it wasn't signed tonight, because I think if I'm understanding, Rachel, I just want to understand. So where you're reading about the town of Scarborough review, you're reading that to mean Town Scarborough Planning Board review, where I think, I know I'm reading, I believe the DOT is reading, it's the Town Scarborough staff. So maybe it's just the simple insertion of Town Scarborough staff may get to your issue. Again, I haven't.
And I'll just be quick, but the intent is for a review of the detailed design plans, all the information that goes with the design plan, so it's ready to go to construction the following year. That's what's the intent of those dates, so that the member comes around, approved design, you can bid it and get ready for construction the following year is how that time frame sort of, you know, is supposed to.
Engineering.
So, and then my question becomes, if it isn't put in on time, or if the developer falls behind, then everything stops.
Comes to a stop.
Comes to a stop. It might be important for the planning board certainly to have a sense if something's going to come to a stop. So to have some sense of where things are in terms of timing and in terms of completed activities. And again, that can be some sort of a scorecard, because this is going to get very complicated. It might be that we can look and we can say four things done and say that's wonderful, but those four things only took a month, and the fifth thing that's left is going to take a year. So it's very helpful for us to really be clear on how things are progressing, and again, give us in language that's not Maine DOT, because I'm reading this differently. And I'm perfectly willing to say I probably have no idea what I'm doing or what they're really saying. But I kept looking at this language and trying to parse it and come up with how that was going to work. And it would be very helpful to start off, you know, with an understanding of different roles and time and what we can expect and when we can expect things or if we're going to expect things. And the more we can come to that sort of partnership with everybody, because now things start coming to us as the planning board. As developments come. Now we become a partner in making sure this works. Well, and that just brought all the conversation to a halt. And there are other questions, other discussion for the planning board or the transportation committee. Observations, questions?
To sort of elaborate a little bit more on what I think Angela was talking about, and this is sort of much larger picture thing, probably relevant at the council level or among several town groups. But I know that in the past, the Transportation Committee has looked at, for example, particular intersections. I think it came up at Oak Hill, and a couple of other signalized intersections where we've started to talk about adaptive equipment, and the question really comes up about, for me always anyway, if we're talking about adding equipment, today we have this amazing advantage of this technology, which is something that wasn't necessarily widely available even a short time ago. But do we know, we don't really know how much more efficient these signals could get, or how much more capacity we have on Route 1. You know, we're not going to widen Route 1. So at some point, it becomes, you know, we're attention to the fact that this project is not going to trigger. We know that intersection needs work or will need work at some point in the near future. This project doesn't trigger that. How much capacity is left at that intersection, and what's the plan? You know, what's the plan for it further down? So, as we all saw on this, you know, this first sheet, the project. What was your initial study area? Like 2 miles, a 2 mile radius beyond the project.
Further out where we thought.
Yeah.
Sure. So I'm guessing in some cases that covered areas that were not in Scarborough, and in other cases it doesn't touch parts of Scarborough. So just generally, I'm curious about how the Transportation Committee and the town in general will be able to use this tremendous amount of work and sort of build upon it in the future, so that we, you know, are armed in it and we're starting from a good place, understanding what this means for the rest of our transportation network. And, you know, in particular, I've got to believe that that would be pretty relevant to any conversation about adjusting traffic impact fees and that structure in the future. If we don't know where we are currently up against capacity issues, how might we know where we would need to collect funds for in the future? So, sort of a little bit larger than the town's topic on its own. A lot of my questions have been answered. I know that there's, I don't know that it's really been driven home, but having participated in several much smaller scale meetings, like, you know, kind of what we're talking about here, just the sheer number of people. There isn't a single person in the transportation industry in the southern part of the state that I think hasn't been involved in this project in one way or another for a very long time. So, you know, I can't imagine, I mean, I like it, but I can't imagine what that must have been. So much work has been done. One thing I didn't hear very much about that I'm curious about is how this permit will monitor, or if it will monitor, any sort of shared trips that you were kind of talking about at the very beginning. So I understand that the permit is defined by an estimated number of trips, but if I were you, and I know that you've been looking at this already, it would, you know, it is to your advantage to try and have fewer trips coming on and off of your site. So I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about how that relates to this permit in particular, and just sort of in general, not needing to go super in depth, but what your vision is for how that will play out through the rest of the development.
I mean, one thing that I don't think is off the table is to do actual counts when we're approaching. I mean,
I actually made a note of a permanent counter. I wonder if you could talk about that. I'm sure they're expensive. I don't really know much about it, but it would be a super interesting from a data standpoint.
So, I mean, what's interesting as part of the study, we did not take any trip reductions as part of any type of multimodal, trips so it's kind of a worst case, actually theoretically a worst case, you know, vehicle trip study. The idea was, you know, basically we took a reduction for internal interaction that Dan talked about. I live and work within a Downs, so we made some assumptions about reduction for that, but we didn't make any reductions in parking, like maybe biking, taking transit. You know, certainly the whole development is implementing, you know, a type of infrastructure system that really is meant to like do that, and so we didn't. And so so I do think, you know, monitoring and thinking about how it would change makes some sense, you know, in the future. You know, DOT has no interest in monitoring, and so we'll just stay within their trip level. And then the other thing, your first comment that I was
turn left on Payne because they don't want to make the left because it's a long queue. So the signal's going to change some things. So there'll be some need to monitor, come back, and see how things are shaken out. I mean, it's going to be a dynamic situation for the next number of years.
If I could jump in on that too. This is 3,000 trips. It's our best guess at what's coming at us at the downs. It's probably not everything that's going to get done at the downs. There's another bite of the apple here coming. We just don't know what. Could be 5 years, could be 10. It depends on how things go with the downs. But I absolutely believe there's another bite of the apple. We're going to have to do another study and another EMP at some point in time. I realize 3,000 trips is a lot, but
you're filling the mess.
There's a lot of new stuff happening. There's a lot of new stuff happening here. That's just going to be that.
I am also curious. So we were very clear about which mitigation elements would be happening in which years. And again, not trying to get too much into the weeds, but I'm curious if someone could give sort of a high-level overview of how those were determined beyond we want to make Payne Road improvements first because we, you know, the Innovation District is sort of coming online more so than somewhere else. Or maybe that's it. I'm not sure. I just didn't know if it was, you know, if it's trip based, but you're not quite sure which uses are coming in. That maybe that's part of all of the complexity. But I didn't know if there was another rationale
for
that at all, such that if your development didn't progress at perhaps the rate. I mean, we all hope it does, but. You know, who knows what could happen, and so I'm just curious what may or may not happen to alter the schedule of things that you've laid out.
I think the biggest change that could happen is if, you know, downtown ramps up and goes quick with Newton Center Street. Mm-hmm. Now we're out with Ice Parkway, Center Street, that piece. That's why we try to kick it to the end, but knowing it could move up whenever it needs to. That's we know we've got the Innovation District. It's been very successful. It's moving forward. We know we've got traffic there. So it made sense to do that end of the project. The other end, we've got the residential stuff going. It made sense to get to Route 1. Everybody knows Oak Hill needs love. So it just seemed like those were the right plays. And then Center Street can come whenever the market says, hey, the downtown's coming.
And those are the front door. And then the other things we actually based more on the town and DOT. I mean, the town wanted to do Route 1 next year as soon as possible, the adaptive. DOT is very interested in the payment of the quarter being done. So, like, those were more making it kind of predictable, but sort of coordinating with.
Yeah, I was going to jump into the town's point of view, and we went back and forth too. I know we started pretty close to that, but we kind of massaged things around. But I think the town also has some input, like you're saying, that Town Council had already approved our CIP for those 5 intersections on Route 1, knowing that really needs to go. We also are already, we're in final design of North Scarborough, knowing that most likely will happen in that 2023. So we kind of pushed them to move that to kind of accommodate what we're doing as well. And then also in the DOTs, we talked about the Business Partnership Initiative is really looking at how you group those in enough projects so that you get the DOT to contribute the maximum amount of funds that they have allowed for each year. So it kind of had the package in a certain cost bracket to all the projects. So there was a lot to it, and a lot of players all requesting probably different things. But I think we were all pretty close to start. It was just a little bit of moving things around that to get us to where we were.
I think it's important to note that, you know, these time frames, these 5 years, we're tied to that. We've got to make those improvements from start to finish. We've got 9 things we're going to do in year 1. We've got to get all 9 of those done. Tom's team has to get plans done so they're in the hands of the town to finalize and approve. The DOT finalizes and approves it. We put it out for bid the first of the year, and it goes in the ground. If we don't finish that year, our permit's done. We've got a problem. So there's a lot of pressure on us to perform, and I think, you know,
Travis Parkway, because that was also on my list of concerns. Route 1 entrance is really the residential and the quiet entrance, the soft entrance, whatever you want to call it. But until there's an exit on Haggis Parkway, Route 1 is going to be the exit and entrance that people are going to use, unless they're specifically going to work probably in innovation, you know, in which case they would head there. And you know, from a perspective of people starting to make phone calls to you or to the town council, as traffic picks up, as more buildings go in, and there's more traffic going by the uplands, and more traffic going by some of the condos there, there are going to be some people who are going to say, well, wait a minute, I thought, you know, I didn't think we were going to be the main way in. So that Center Street assumes a psychological importance, and it assumes, it also is kind of a safety valve as you get more houses in there, a way for people to get out onto, that doesn't get them back out onto Route 1 and up to Oak Hill immediately. So that the more you can take a look at Haggis, at that entrance at Haggis Parkway, and the completion of Center Street, I think the better off the Downs is in terms of people saying it's not the main problem, it's not the traffic problem, it's not causing all the traffic. And right now I think out there there's a perception that the Downs is causing traffic problems. And I don't think it is. But the more houses that go in, the more that can happen. The more places on the Downs where people can stay to have their cup of coffee, or to get their dry cleaning, or complete in some errands, the more they stay in the Downs area, then the less traffic you get on the main street. So you get out onto Route 1. So you've got that balance to be worried about as well, and I think to think through. So I was very happy when you said, well, good start in 24, because I think it's going to be needed. It's going to be needed faster than you think, I believe. And I believe that it's an important safety valve, even though it will push a lot of traffic past Scott O'Hill Road. It'll take me a long time to get out and turn left up Haggis Parkway. But I think it is, I think it's important. So anything that you can do along that line of starting that movement, I think would be important.
It's certainly on our radar, and frankly, Brother Bill had his way, it would be in 22. We need a couple levers to get hold, and I absolutely believe we can get ramped up, you know, before the last year. We just need a couple things to happen.
Do we have a question? Yeah.
I want to ask the question about transit, public transit, because that to me is an exciting opportunity to offload traffic. What is the plan? I know you said it was in its infancy and you're getting ready to pay for public transport or transit, but what is the route? And I mean, I can see, depending on whether we can get people excited about taking it, getting local businesses to say, gee, I'll be supportive of a local shelter and I'll put my, you know, bench there and so on. You know, I think that if we went to the mall and certainly downtown to Portland, that people would use it.
Yeah, I'll speak to what's already there, and then Jay, I'm sure, can I comment on what's coming. But so we also saw a lot of value in transit right off the bat for the first phase of residential area close to the line. So we actually, on our own initiative, went to Zoom, which is the bus from Saga River to Portland, and said, hey, can you just come in and start serving the project, not just sit by if you want. And so, yeah, give us compensation for it. So we wanted kind of a seed money to say, all right, we're going to try this, and we're new with the residential phase, so we'll tag annually to get you kind of divert a little bit. And so we have a shelter within the first days, and they come in and out of the project already. So we were just trying to capitalize on the group that exists, but to get some benefit from it. So that's our kind of initial investment, because that's really the only transit that comes in where it goes to the project. The other piece is the study. So we're in the TMP funding half of a study that the town is involved in, PACS, the regional planning agency, and the transit providers are all involved in. And that's just starting right now. So the process is to study, like, how can the town be served by any number of transit agencies, but also, just as importantly, how can it activate service to, like, the greater area. It's not just the town, there's Oak Hill and other parts.
Yeah,
so,
we set up a network.
Yeah, so, but there's enough, there's some nice things about the town that has, so you need a certain density per acre, to be able to take the service. So the town checks a lot of those boxes, ultimately, and, like, having enough people, employers, et cetera, to start to justify things. It's figuring out the details. And what agencies, you know, add what boots to serve it. And I'm hoping it's a productive study that has, like, some tangible, you know, like, next steps. So that,
yeah,
that's great.
Yeah, I think, you know, part of the study really came from, again, sort of early discussions around, you know, I think, Tom, you were mentioning about capture trips, and you haven't taken any credit for, I'm not sure what you call them, you know, the transit trips, right? Because, but there was sort of that conversation, and DOT was like, well, there isn't any transit, so how can you take any credit? So we really started this conversation around, this is, we hope, right? We're hopeful, we want it to work, so really it was a discussion around having PACS take the lead to start a study that really looks at ridership opportunities. You know, okay, we're gonna have a nice, you know, center of gravity here at the Downs, but what could connect to that? What is the likelihood of there being ridership? And as Dan said, once we find out that, yeah, you know what, it does look like this could work, that's sort of the limited portion of this study, but it'll have sort of the next steps to say, okay, now that we actually see this is a viable, potentially viable thing, here are the next steps we need to take to, you know, funding's going to be a key piece, right? Mm-hmm. Who are the providers going to be? What are the as you just said, the trips? What's the network look like?
Right.
What road are they going up? So I think this is the first sort of foundational step to say, okay, is there the density, as Dan was just talking about, in population to make this a viable alternative? And if so, what do we do next? And that study's supposed to, you know, we had our kickoff meeting a week or two ago, and they were talking about having reporting out by the end of the year. So expect January, February, right? That's the way these things go.
Good expectation.
Realistic.
Come on.
That's because the town doesn't respond.
are there any other questions or observations from the board or committee?
I just have one. Rocky was saying that, you know, it's kind of a developing thing, we all know that. But the improvements that are on this list, these aren't like, you know, we'll see what happens and we'll take them off. So these ones are actually all scheduled, required by the traffic.
We have to meet that schedule.
Okay. So we might do, you know, as things progress, if things go really great, and then we could do additional, we could add to this list or make different improvements, but everything on this list is required by the traffic movement plan, and this stuff will be done by these deadlines, right?
It's required, yeah.
I thought that was the case. I just wanted to clarify that.
As I understand it, there's no penalty for getting something done sooner.
Correct.
Just wanted to make sure.
All right, thank you. I just have one observation, and that's the fact that, again, this is another great example of staff and developer and the different committees in the town and of course, planning board. How we can all, taking this time to do this workshop will help us in our Monday meetings that go till 10:30 at night. So I want to thank you guys for setting the stage here and getting it so that a layman like me that has no idea about traffic actually start to understand it a little bit. So my observation is you've done a great job bringing us in line with what your plans are.
And I want to echo what Rick said and appreciate the work that that's been done, and especially the ability of the folks sitting across the table here to work with MDOT on what's really a monster process and to create that sort of a partnership. I think that says a lot for the skills and knowledge of the people involved. So I appreciate that, and I'm sure we will hear, the planning board will hear from Jay or Jamel on the next steps that we will be taking a look at, that we have our work cut out for us. I want to tell you, when Jay asked everybody to take a look at the workshop that was given, I did look at it. I contemplated making up a pop quiz and start this off just to see.
I actually attended it, so I even know what the price tag is.
So, but it's very, very clear, and I really appreciate the work of the board and committee members, because it's clear you folks really dug into this and came here ready to really learn and to contribute. So thank you to the committee members, thank you to the staff and the development team. Thank you, and we are adjourned.